I didn't just want to wait until I do an intro video of how I got here, because I thought this video would be more helpful for people who are traveling, since Canada has actually extended the ban till September. Hello everyone. So now I just sat down after a walk. I had gone to Dollarama, then I had gone for my photo ID. So after that I've just walked a little bit more towards where I stay, and then I'm just sitting on one of the benches here at the park. It's absolutely a wonderful climate. It's sunny as well as windy and a little chill, so I'm enjoying it. So now currently I am at the, I'll have to check, the Draggers Car Racing Park. That's what this place is called. I don't know why it's called that way, but then it's called that. So yeah, that's where I am. I don't know when you'll see this vlog, but then I thought I'll just record it and keep it so that you guys can see it. I don't know whether the screen is covering, my face is covering up the full screen. Anyways, so one of the thing that I thought I will talk about is that, as you all know, I just got here 2 days back, and then I had actually taken an indirect route through Cairo. So I'll tell you how that happened. So I am basically from Kerala, Trivandrum in India. And so from Trivandrum, I took a flight to Muscat, Oman, and from there to Cairo, Cairo to Toronto, and Toronto to Saskatoon. So that was my route. Few things that I wanted to say is the main reason why I'm making this video, even before putting an intro video of how I got to Canada, why I got to Canada, all those things, I just wanted to let you guys know about the route that I took. Okay, so whoever is planning to come through Cairo, please watch this video till the end, and I will also put some other videos which I took at the airport so that you guys know what I'm talking about. So my flight was on the 8th, 8th by around 9:45 in the morning. So I boarded the flight from Trivandrum. There were some goof ups at the Trivandrum airport also. I took an Oman Air flight from Trivandrum to Muscat. The flight was excellent. I mean, the service was spot on, the food was good, everything was good. You'll see a lot of linked videos in this. Then we reached Oman. Till then it was fine. So I had booked my tickets through a travel agency at Trivandrum called as Legacy Travels. So the service was excellent. I was handled by one Miss Nisha. She did an excellent job, and she booked the package for me. So it came up to 2 lakhs and plus, around 2.3, because I opted for a single sharing room. So I'd initially booked my flights through Emirates, but then it didn't work out. As you all know, UAE's put a ban on flights from India. So I took a flight to Oman, and till then it was fine. So basically it was like a chartered service for around 300 passengers, and Legacy was a point of contact for me. But the actual tour operator was Ria Travels. I think they're based in Mumbai, and they have a lot of branches all over India. So Ria Tours were the main operators, and I used to coordinate directly with Legacy because I booked it through them. Overall, till Trivandrum, there was absolutely no assistance from Ria, which they had informed earlier. They told there'll be somebody from Oman or Egypt to assist us completely, which was not the case. We reached Oman and there was nobody to assist, so we figured out how to get there. And there were other students also who actually was part of the tour, and we also had some senior citizens, infants, family, everybody's traveling. So there were around 300 plus passengers just for this particular group. So then finally, after getting to Muscat, we were supposed to take a flight from Muscat by around evening 4:45 to Egypt, again Oman Air. The flight was full. Comparatively, the service was just okay, but there was enough leg room, the food was okay. They had opted for vegetarian. I think it was a deal with Ria that they opted for vegetarian meals. I'm not sure whether you can hear me, but let's try. So after that, we actually reached Egypt, And I was so glad, okay, you know, everything is going well and, you know, I'm reaching Canada and then, you know, I'm excited and all those things. And that ended there, okay. So we reached Cairo, we got out of the flight, just reached the gate where we have to enter the airport, and then some officers from the airport came and told, no, this is a restricted area, you have to stay in this area. That's to all the 300 passengers. You have to stay in this area, you're not supposed to go anywhere from here, just be here until we give you any further notice. And they just asked us to sit there. So all of us are like looking around and we were like, okay, where should we sit, you know? And then finally we realized, okay, floor, that's where we have to sit. Or there's a railing where we can sit. Okay, some of us were like, okay, let's check out, you know, how it's going to be and maybe a couple of hours and all those things. We kept waiting for I don't know how many hours. We got so fed up that people started sitting on the floor after some time. So we landed at 7 p.m. at Egypt time, Cairo time. And then realized that it's going to take forever. So what we actually did was we asked the officials how much time it's going to take and all those things. But we had absolutely no clue. There was absolutely no coordination from Riyadh Travels. We tried calling them a lot of times, or most of the passengers. So all these 300 passengers have been traveling with us throughout. So we kind of made friends with each other and all. Finally, we realized that the delay was because we had to do an antigen test, which we were aware of right from the start. But then it took forever for them to actually call us for the test. After around 4-5 hours, they asked the first batch of passengers to come, that is 1 to 50. They had actually numbered us and my number was 135. One of my friend whom I met at Muscat during the travel, whom I made friends with, her number was 222. So only 1 to 50 had gone for the antigen test and they never came back, you know. And then we were sitting and wondering, okay, fine, what's happening? And then we were like, okay, let's take a nap. So literally all these passengers, we were lying on the floor. I'll put the video here, you'll get to see it. We were so frustrated and tired, and the worst part is we didn't have any access to food or water initially, and also to use a toilet. Okay, so when we asked them, they told, no, this is the area that you have to stay in, you cannot cross this area. Finally we convinced them we could use the washrooms, but then food and water was not there. So whoever had carried water or food or some biscuits and all, we were sharing with the others. Finally, what happened is after a point we decided, okay, we just can't sit and wait like this, right? So we decided that we are going to talk to the officials and see what can be done. So finally we headed over to the counter. We told them, you know, we want to meet the officers and all. They told, no, it's not possible, you just need to wait here, it might take a couple of hours more. It's already like 6 hours by then. So after a point, just some of us, we just decided, no, this is not done, you know, we just can't keep waiting. We tried calling Riyadh Travels, absolutely no response from them. They just kept telling, you know, we are arranging food and water for you outside the airport. And we were like, what is the point? We need to get out of the airport, because part of this package was a one night and 2 days stay at Cairo at a hotel there called as Oasis Pyramids. So basically we wanted to go to the hotel, freshen up, take rest, because we have been out since that day early morning by around 5, okay. So we just wanted to go back to the hotel, but then there was no way out. There was absolutely nobody to ask, nobody to coordinate, no water, no food. And I mean, see, I understand that it's not a big deal, okay. But then the problem was, it was none of our fault. Like in a sense, it was not our fault that why we were stuck there. All our documents were in place. There was absolutely no issues. It was just the problem with the immigration. Later we realized that they were short staffed. There were hardly anybody to do the test or, you know, to guide us. And then we just decided, you know, we're just going to go in batch of 10 to 15 or 20 and then get the antigen test. Let's not wait for their instructions. So somehow we sneaked in, we went down to the area where they were taking the antigen test. Again, when they saw us, they told, no, you just need to wait. And they actually gave priority to some flight that came from Paris. Finally, you know, by then I think it was around 8 to 9 hours that we were stuck in that airport. Finally, we told, okay, fine, you know, this is not done. So we kept talking to officers here and there, but then there was no luck. Basically, we just had to wait, and people were tired, and you know, you can imagine the situation, right? Like, see, the saddest part is all of us had like ripped our pocket to pay for this trip, and there were infants, people who were on wheelchairs, there were senior citizens. All these people were just struggling and frustrated when we were sitting there. So I thought I was in a better state of mind or in a better situation, because at least, you know, I don't have any ailments, or I didn't have anything to be too much worried about, like, all, you understood, right? Like, no kids or all those things. So I decided that I'm not going to complain, but at least help the others. So one of my friend Reshma, whom I met at Muscat, both of us went and talked. Reshma took a lot of initiative, and she was talking to the officials and figuring things out. Finally, I think on the 9th hour or the 10th hour, they started calling us for antigen tests, and that's when we realized they were short staffed. There was one person taking the antigen test, I mean the swabs from the nose, for all these passengers coming from all these flights all over the world, and there was one person. He's not even wearing gloves, and he was saying, we were actually scared that we might get COVID from that guy. And then there were two people who were doing the test and also stamping the passports, you know, with that saying that we are negative or positive. So I got out of the airport after 12 hours, around 11 or 12 hours. So finally, when my passport was stamped, we just needed the visa. Immigration officer, he didn't have much job. It was mainly one guy whom I don't want to actually abuse, but he's the one who actually goofed up most of the things. So he actually told us that, you know, we'll have to wait, and he kept he was so irresponsible and did us no help, in fact a lot of trouble. Finally, by around I think 5 in the morning or 5:30 in the morning, Ria had organized for some food and water for us from the hotel that we were supposed to stay in. So that one night we were supposed to stay in the hotel was done. We stayed at the airport, in fact. So the situation was so bad. In fact, I mean, seeing some people, I felt really bad, because out of us, one girl got tested positive in the antigen test, then she was taken for RT-PCR, all these kind of things. And finally, we got out of the hotel by around, 7 in the morning. Yeah, so 8 in the morning, sorry, 8 in the morning. Again, we had to wait for all the passengers to board the flight, board the bus. Finally, we reached the hotel at 9 a.m. Okay, so that's more than 12 hours that we were stranded here and there. So whoever is planning to take the Cairo route, be prepared, okay? Because I heard, even before travel, I knew I had to wait for like 4 to 5 hours. But this was ridiculous, because for what? Like, we didn't pay so much money to just, you know, rot at the airport. So please check with your, see, it's, I can't blame the travel agent for this, because it's not their fault. But one thing I felt was there was absolutely no coordination from the travel agent. So maybe that's the reason why things goofed up, because we saw other people having a better priority, or, you know, they were given better consideration. But our group wasn't. They just kept saying, telling, you know, there were other two flights from India, and, you know, that's why there's a delay. That's none of our business, right? Like, we really needn't bother about that. So yeah, that's how Cairo episode happened. Then we went to the hotel. The hotel service was good. It was called as Oasis Paradise. It was very close to where the pyramids and Sphinx are in Giza, I think. But then we couldn't go out, because we reached only at 9 a.m. At 9 a.m. they started the RT-PCR test, which we had to carry to Canada as the third country RT-PCR test. So basically, we went. I didn't even have breakfast. I directly went for the RT-PCR because I didn't want to waste time. Then I directly went to the room, freshened up, you know, slept for some time, skipped lunch also. Finally, by around 4:30 or 5, I just got out, you know, went to bench near the pool, and, you know, there was a small cafe. I sat there and had coffee. And from there, Yeah, so I asked my agent, is it possible to go out and see, you know, do a little bit of sightseeing. He told no, because the RT-PCR is there, you cannot. It will be invalid. So from there, so by around, then they told us by 6:30 or 7, we have to leave the resort or check out, and dinner will be ready by then. So we had our dinner by around 5:30 in the evening. By around 7, most of us had checked out. We got the report, printed reports from them. So all this is part of the package, okay? The stay, the report, the visa at Egypt, all these things are part of the package. So finally, we actually reached the airport by around 10. Again, the immigration was terrible. For each passenger, they were spending around 15-20 minutes to check the all their records. And I don't know why they were doing it. It was not necessary for them to do it, because they were even checking our timetables, which we for the classes that we are supposed to attend. Ideally, the Canadian immigration should do that, but instead of that, you know, the Cairo immigration was doing it. Finally, what happened? Yeah, so I opted for a business class after the Cairo incident, because I really needed rest and had to catch up on some sleep again, so I had to shell out some money for that. Finally, we boarded the flight from Cairo. The flight was good. It was Egyptian Air. It was exclusively for these 300 passengers. Flight was full, obviously. And then, yeah, so from there we reached Toronto by, again, it was delayed by 1 hour. We were supposed to leave by 3:45, but we left by around 4:45, and we reached Canada, Toronto, by around 9:45 in the morning. Finally, we reached. So I was so excited. Okay, fine, I've reached Canada and yuppie and all those things. So as soon as I got out, I sent a selfie to my family that I've reached Canada. And obviously, I was tensed about the immigration, because I've heard that, you know, they might not give the study permit if we don't actually justify why we are here. But it was smooth. Okay, like, I can't tell you how smooth the Canadian immigration was. They just asked us a couple of questions, as of, you know, why you're here, how long is your course, and when are you planning to leave, and what course are you studying for, are you carrying more than $10,000 of cash, all these kind of questions, and which I could give answers to both. So you just need to be very confident while you give these answers, because that's what they're looking for. So once you answer all these things, they issue the study permit. So in Canada, once you enter, you have a border security who will ask for your vaccination reports and also whether you have a negative RT-PCR. So once you show that to them, they will give you a receipt. You have to take that and go to the immigration. So after the immigration, they'll just ask you to go. I had a connecting flight to Saskatoon at 6:45. So they asked to proceed to the luggage area. I collected the luggage, and then I had gone for my testing at Toronto. So few things I wanted to tell is, see, one is how to put up the ArriveCan app, which I will do it in another video. Most of you might know, but yeah, I'll explain it in another video. Another thing is registering yourself in the Switch app, Switch Health. It's not an app, basically it's a web portal. I kept searching Google Play for the app and I never found it. Finally, I found out that it's just a website wherein you need to register your details. So you actually you put in your details, you register yourself, so that you don't have to stand in a separate queue and do the registration once you reach there. You are pre-registered, so you have a different queue. You just go there and they will ask you to go to a counter. You get your kit, you go to a testing counter, and then you get yourself tested, and then you leave. Okay, that's it. But if you haven't registered in the Switch Health app, they will ask you to stand there and register, where you know you might have Wi-Fi, you might not have Wi-Fi. Toronto Wi-Fi was really good, by the way. So you'll have to do that, and then once you're tested, so if you're fully vaccinated, you don't have a home test to be done. You just can directly walk out, and they'll upload the report on the Switch Health portal itself, and then you are out. Okay, so you will find a lot of shops now. So While I was talking to my husband after that, he told me, why don't you check for a flight which is before 6:45 to Saskatoon. So I did that event. So one thing is, see, in India and all, what happens is you have like so many people at the airport to help you out. I mean humans, okay? But here there are, but they are behind the counter and it's difficult to access them. It's not like they don't have any kiosk where you can go and approach. So it's more of electronic kiosk that you'll have to go. So that's one thing. And then finally you get to, yeah, so that's how it happened. So again I went to the kiosk and then I got myself registered for, I mean I got myself a ticket for the earlier flight, and then headed to the counters. It was a rush because I sat and wasted time for around half an hour talking to family. Then you know the immigration, the security check and everything was very smooth and organized, so it was not much of a hassle. And then boarded to the gate. The flight to Saskatoon was for around 3.5 hours. It was an ATR, the one with the propellers. Yeah, so that flight was also good, a little cramped for me, okay, but then overall the flight was good. I mean there was enough leg space and all. You would have seen those ones in, I don't know, if you're in India, like the Kingfisher one and all, you know, where it's a propeller flight and it flies at one height. So, you know, you can see the clouds and you can see the landscape and all those things. It was good. And then, yeah, I reached Saskatoon. So the cherry on the icing was, I reached Saskatoon. So I found out that there were three other people on the same flight who was going to study in my same college. I talked to them, I came down and I found that a lot of people are standing near the conveyor belt, that's a luggage area, and I just can't find my luggage. So I kept looking, I stood there for 10 minutes 15 minutes, my luggage is not there. And somehow when I actually checked in the luggage at Toronto itself, I was telling my husband, and I somehow have a feeling, I'm not too confident because it was this electronic self check-in kiosk where you just need to put in the luggage, they'll scan the luggage. And so I told him that, but still I was like, okay, it's Canada, you know, nothing can happen. So I reached Saskatoon and then I came to know one of the Air Canada representatives. She came and told, you know, you need to stand in a queue because some of your luggages are missing and, you know, we'll take down your details. I'm like, what the hell, you know, like I have traveled the world, like not the world exactly, but at least half of the world, like across the world. I come to Toronto, till then it was fine. I come to Saskatchewan and my luggage is not there. So these are the two suitcases or the luggage that I carried all the way from India, which has each and every item that I wanted to bring here. And the only thing I had with me at that point was my shoulder bag, which just had a couple of sanitary and, you know, toiletries and all those things, which was useful for my travel. But my hand luggage didn't even have a piece of clothing. The only thing I had was two files and my laptop. And I'm standing there and wondering, what the hell am I gonna do, you know? And with my size, I can't even borrow clothes from anyone. So I went to the counter and they told, you know, we're really sorry for what happened, and you know, we'll give you a toiletry kit with maybe, you know, a couple of things that you can use initially, and then within a day or two your luggage will be door delivered. And I was like, okay, fine, let's see. And then took a cab from there, reached home. And the service of Air Canada was so good that, you know, they within a day, they deliver the next day morning by around 8 o'clock, my luggage was at home. So you have to describe how your luggage looks and all those things and give the address, and they had delivered it at home. And they also gave a toiletry kit, I'll put the video here, which had a t-shirt and couple of toiletry items like paste and shaving kit and all those things. And to my surprise, the t-shirt fit me. So yeah, I had a piece of cloth clothing for change. So yeah, that's how my trip was. It can't get more exciting than this. And you know, I don't think I'll ever forget the first time I landed in Canada. So yeah, to wind it up, couple of pointers. Have at least one piece of spare clothes in your hand luggage. I know it's difficult, it's only 7 kgs that you can carry, but somehow squeeze in at least shorts or a shirt or something of that sort. Another thing is, Caro route, just think about it. If you're okay with all the hassle, then go ahead. But I wouldn't suggest it. There are better routes like Male and all where my friends have come. I'll try to get them on a call and see how the route was. Mainly because of Caro immigration, so just be careful of that. And then just pack yourself a little bit of extra water, or you know, some of the places they don't allow water, they might just dispose it, but at least some biscuits or something that you can carry, so that you can get into the airport and buy water, so that should be okay. So get some stuff for yourself, you know, so that you can survive in case something of this sort comes in. And then have US dollars in hand, because everywhere that is accepted. Or you should have an international a card that you can use internationally. I had used my Axis Bank debit or credit card for usage, like when I want to buy food, water. Yeah, so these are a couple of things. Other than that, yeah, I've reached Canada, so finally my destination that I've been trying for like 3 years. I hope this video was helpful for you guys. Stay tuned for more updates on, you know, how the travel was, how I got here, how I reached here at the age of 37, and I'm still going to study, which I don't know how I'm going to do. But I'll explain those in the upcoming videos. I didn't just want to wait until I do an intro video of how I got here, because I thought this video would be more helpful for people who are traveling, since Canada has actually extended the ban till September. So whoever's taking the indirect route, please consider all the pros and cons and then travel, because you'll end up spending a lot of money from your hand during the travel in case it's not smooth. So that's it. Yeah, so I'm not going to review any travels or airlines or anything, because airlines all were good. There were absolutely no promises, Caro immigration and the coordination from Ria Travels. But I would highly recommend Legacy Travels in Trivandrum if anybody's trying to book. They're very, very professional and the coordination was excellent. Even Ria Travels, to the fact they had a pre-departure call and all, but at the destination, their coordination was really bad. So stay tuned, guys. I hope this was helpful. If you have any questions regarding any of these things, you know, just drop me a message in my comments and I'll respond to you. Let me know what else you want to know. I'm at Saskatchewan, at Saskatoon. If you know, want to know something specific about this place or any place in Canada, I can research and find out and let you guys know. And anything regarding student visa or how you can get here at this age or anything, you know, I have done enough and more research, so whatever information I have, I can pass it on to you guys. Bye.